if the whole class is a different biographers, you know, biography of people, and I think we model each other. We don't just think about problems. We think about, do I want to think about this problem like this other person? And so here's four other ways we can solve environmental problems that nobody's really talked about before. And there's, of course, me, but I'm going to give a hybrid critique. Why is it hybrid? Because it's not exclusively a social thing. It's not exclusively about environmental systems. It's all about the dynamics of how social, biological, physical interacts. And I'm going to critique Malthus, Beck, which is the risk society view, Jaspers, which I've already talked about in the axial age dynamics. I'm going to critique Marx as well. It's very interesting. You've probably seen that the way I structured part three is, if you notice, everybody that critiques Malthus, a lot of them are Marxists. And, you know, Malthusians typically also critique Marx. So Marx and Malthus are kind of arch enemies of thinking. Like, you know, some people look at environmental problems in a biological way, and those tend to be think about as human impact directly, biologically, and scale of population. That's a very biological view. But other people think, no, humans are organizational, and it's our social and organizational structures that create environmental problems, not just the total number of people. And so therefore the important things are social, particularly economic organizations. And those are more Marxist analysis of environmental problems. So I disagree with both. And that's why I wanted to leave you that it's possible to do both. I haven't talked much about this in this class, but one word of advice for really the rest of your life. If you find that you think that there's a clear dichotomy in your thinking, it's probably wrong because a dichotomy is just in your head, like, you know, left and right politics. Is that the only amount kind of politics there are? No. Or Marx versus Malthus. Is that the only kind of politics there is in thinking about environmental? No. So whenever you find in your life that you think you have this total opposition between different, there's probably a third option that you're ignoring. And your thinking would be good if you look into, you know, cases that are merged like that, that, you know, what's the interaction of population and social organization at the same time, for instance, or and not so deductive, because I think people, they spend their lives sort of in opposition to somebody else. They adopt something, but that also means they are in total opposition to another perspective. And I think that makes us very weak in our problem solving. I think we're stronger intellectually if you realize that you are blocking your own thinking from something. And that's a dichotomy. Look up that word, false dichotomy, if you don't understand that term. But what I'm saying is, I think Malthus versus Marx is kind of a false dichotomy that has totally missed the issue. And the issue, I think, has nothing to do with Marx and nothing to do with Malthus. It has to do with our choices, our particular choices of materials. And Marx doesn't talk about that. And Malthus doesn't talk about that. So this is a different view that I'm going to argue for, that the ontology, you know, my OEMF, the ontology here, what does Whitaker think? Me about environmental problems, I think it's choices, you know, our choices that we live in. Which particular materials? Are we choosing oil? Are we choosing solar? Are we choosing, you know, synthetic chemicals for herbicides and pesticides? Are we using ecological cycles? Marx or, you know, can't really talk about that. Malthus doesn't even care about that. Neither does Marx. So I think this is a totally different path to think about this hybrid issue of our social choices of biological and physical things. And I have four ways to think about fixing environmental problems this way. And it's, of course, I've already mentioned this, but what's my, you know, methods? My methods in the past has been a comparative historical, a modernist perspective. A modernist means I look at the past and the present. I don't just look at the modern things and assume that that's the only data there is. So I'm very much interested in comparisons. Past and present. The only people that we've really talked about in part two that are like part two like this were Elias and Simmel. Elias was very interested in the deep past and the hyper modern present. Same as Simmel. Simmel didn't care whether his examples of social forms came from 2000 years ago or they came from now. But many of the other thinkers are very modernist, like definitely Marx. Marx felt something new and modern was happening. So did Durkheim, so did, but I'm saying, well, there's always been urbanization. I mean, all these people, there's always been kind of inequality. It's not just a new thing around capitalism or big cities, but they've always had big cities, but they come and go. So, you know, an a-modernist view sort of looks for comparisons not and tries to build an idea from the larger data set of all human history and not just, you know, current conditions. Anyway, long thing, but I'll hold this slide for a minute. But intellectually, what am I doing? I'm critiquing three major things here. I'm critiquing Malthus, as it says at the top, right? I'm also critiquing Marxism and eco-Marxism, which was number three. I'm also critiquing the idea of eco-Asianism, which I mentioned slightly last time, but I'll mention even more now. But you know, what is Malthus? Malthus is the idea that population everywhere is guilty of environmental problems. So if you believe that, your fixes always will be focused on reducing population in some different tactics. What's Marxism? Marxism is the idea that capitalism is guilty for environmental degradation. And I'm going to disagree with that as well. I'm going to conditionally think about that. Also, eco-Asianism, the idea that only one region of the world, modern Europe region alone, is guilty for all the world's environmental degradation. I think I've said this before, but I wish it was that simple. I wish that's the only thing that mattered, because then it'll be easy to solve. It's one person to blame, everybody else is innocent. But the real history, I think, is below. Because I think environmental degradation is a common civilizational problem. That it happened in Asia before Europe was even there. It happened in South India before the British ever got there. Of course, when the British did arrive in some of these places, it improved, it, you know, set up a new kind of inequality, but it was just the same with a different kind of leadership. So my point is, we can learn about these bad trends of environmental problems that the whole world has, and we can learn from each other this way. Like, we can learn how to fix Europe by looking at ancient Japan. We can learn how to fix modern China by looking at South India, you know, hundreds of years ago, because the dynamics, I'm arguing, of the problem is quite the same. That there are pressures for environmental problems, and there are always people trying to fix things. So I think that's a better ontology. That, you know, all regions have a dual history of environmental degradation and sustainability. Why? Because there are unrepresentative choices in a society at the same time, in the same society, that there are representative choices. So there are good materials and bad materials competing for, at the same time. And we don't know the future outcome. And so that's the point, that there's this open-ended future where you can't predict what's happening. It really depends on your actions of which particular things you choose. And that's my second point. One is a common civilizational problem, past and present, in all regions of the world. And I think environmental degradation is about particular choices of materials. It's not about ownership. It's about these regimes of materials that cause environmental problems because they're not representative. They weren't really chosen by markets. They weren't voted on. They're sort of imposed upon people. And it's sometimes a huge form of violence upon regions and groups that they never chose these relationships imposed on them. Think about slavery and plantations. You can't really say that environmental degradation in a place where there's a plantation culture for sugar is caused by too many workers. It's basically caused by somebody choosing to put sugar there and to force other people to work for them. And that simultaneously degrades individual humans and people as well as the environment. So that's my point. Those two points that to critique this, we're getting specific about certain materials on the one side, but there's also a generalization that we can learn from each other globally of how to fix environmental problems by looking at any region of the world. But the four things is an abbreviation, like everything in this class. I'll give you another abbreviation to think about my choices of fixing things. So this is a phrase here. You can remember choices, you remember, solve the ecological tyranny. And if you remember that, you can remember these abbreviations, just choices, comma, URMR. I'll explain that in a minute, solved, SVD, ecological tyranny. So this is the way you can unpack the four ways that I think we can fix environmental problems that are very different than Malthus, Marx, and other people. First, choices. You know, that's very optimistic. You know, we choose to create environmental problems or we choose to fix them. So you really need to look at how did we choose particular materials that create these problems and what are the other options for fixing them? So it's kind of a technical fix, right? It's a technical fix, but it also connects to a hybrid issue that sometimes a technical fix is blocked by social issues. And so if this is true, if point one is true, what does that mean? Why do we have environmental degradation? That means bad choices. And that's what I call URMR, or unrepresentative raw material regimes. A regime is sort of a political term, right? A regime of politics, a regime of this party. North Korea, people call it a regime because it's not very representative. And I want to use that word for materials. Sometimes there are unrepresentative raw material regimes, like certain materials. I would say oil is a good one, that we really near like 100 years ago, oil was not really introduced by markets and people voting on it. It was introduced by a few very powerful groups and certain militaries of the world. And they imposed oil flows on the world for their military purposes. And later, to keep that in place, it was put also into many other technologies. And that regime has a lot of allies. It has allies in industry. It even has allies in society as people consume it and get in the habit of consuming oil. And that's why it's so hard, I think, to change the direction for sustainability, because there is this regime, and the regime is built on our habit. The regime is built on particular technologies that only allow the flow of oil or the burning of oil in cars. And so our whole infrastructure that we live in is part of this regime around oil, for instance. And an unrepresentative one causes environmental degradation. But if it's a choice, you know, just a more representative choices of material energies can solve that environmental problem. So both political regimes exist simultaneously. There are people that promote a very different regime for more green materials and energies, and there are people that support very degradative materials and energies. And that's the way the world is, I think. That's an ontological statement. I think you can see that. In other words, the world is not only about environmental degradation. The world is about people trying to solve it at the same time in their societies. And it's that fight between degradation and sustainability is what I think is happening now. But more controversially or provocatively, I don't think it's controversial, but I think that's exactly the way the world's worked for thousands of years. I mean, there's always been groups trying to make a more sustainable life for themselves against people that are very unrepresentative, destroying their environment. And I think that dynamic in the past looks a lot like the present. It's just the present version is much larger in structure than the past, which is more geographically located. So that's the point, that material choices cause degradation via unrepresentative particular materials. But they don't just stop there. They try to ban or block other choices. And that's the dynamic of leading into the other points. And so if that's true, let's look at an example of oil in a minute. So oil is an example, I think, is an unrepresentative regime. I'm classifying that. I would say there's two phrases important here. One is in the market. You know, something in the market is put there from outside the market by politics, by subsidies, not by capitalism, but by political actors, by militaries. And if you look at oil, it's hard to say that capitalism instituted oil. The real history is sort of a military's instituted oil, and very powerful groups wanted to subsidize oil. And so they encourage its use, and energies that were not based on oil were sort of politically pushed out. And that's what happened in the early 20th century. A lot of people look back and say, oh, markets decided for oil. I think that's not, if the history is something we, the way we measure things, that's not really what happened. Politics intervened and pushed oil over other options. And that's what I mean by an unrepresentative raw material regime. You have to look at the political side of materials and not just the economic side. So with my view of number one, if choices cause more degradation, then we need new choices. And so part of my problem solving is a cognitive fix. And this is a chart that I have of all the categories of different social uses for our materials. So if choices cause environmental degradation or sustainability, then we need new choices. We need to be aware of the choices. And part of my Korean National Research Foundation grant is documenting all the good sustainable choices in 130 categories, just to show it to the world that we have a lot of good options that we can link up together to make a more sustainable world. So you can see how my ontology, if this is my ontology, you can see how that influences my fixes, right? And, you know, my methods, of course, if you're using the OEMF on me, you know, Whitaker's methods are very comparative historical, past and present. His ontology is all about particular flows of materials in society. Nobody's really talked about that yet. Nobody's, you know, in the big six don't really talk about the flows of materials through social relationships. And so my ontology is different. My epistemology, how do I know that? I use a lot of historical analysis in trying to think about these hybrid things. Like when you ask me, well, how do you know that's true? Well, everything I see has a bit of social, biological, physical things in it. There's not a social thing here, it's a biological thing there. Everything really has a social construction of the technology. Actually, there's a whole field in social analysis called SCOT, S-C-O-T. And maybe you've heard of that. SCOT means social construction of technology. But I think that's true. But I also think of SCOM, S-C-O-M, social construction of materials. The materials themselves are social choices. They're not just neutral. They're not just of the market, but they're political regimes in themselves. So analyzing this is very different than just ownership in a Marxist sense, and obviously very different than thinking about population as an important thing, which I don't think it's very important at all. I think even if we had low population, if we still had unrepresentative raw material regimes, we would still have environmental problems because these regimes are directly causing the environmental problems. Their population is indirect on this. It's really directly when you see what is causing degradation, it's particular materials being extracted or moved around or dumped. So you need to think about why people have chosen those materials and try to make new materials. To my examples of oil, there's a few articles here if you're curious. We're not reading these, but a great book you should read once in your life is by a man named Edwin Black called Internal Combustion. This is about the unrepresentative raw material regime of oil, how corporations and governments addicted the world to oil and derail the alternatives. It's not just the rise of markets of oil. There's a political regime that suppressed other technologies. And that's the history of most of the United States. Some places don't have those strong pressures and that they're more market oriented, I think. And they do have better options because of that. There's a really good documentary you could probably find called Who Killed the Electric Car? It's an example of oil regimes killing off electric vehicles in the late 1990s, and then into the early Bush, George W. Bush administration around the year 2000 through 2008. There was a big surge in new electric vehicles, but political regime on the US federal level basically killed that by the changes of rules to facilitate the oil companies dominating politically the markets for energy and transportation. There's a nice good book that I have here. It's called Suppressed Inventions and Other Discoveries. You could download it from this place here, but nonetheless, it's just short chapters, 5 or 6 pages of really good examples that have a lot of repression, that the unrepresentative regimes don't want new alternatives in the market. So the regime is simultaneously a political pressure, but it's also quite a violent pressure, removing technological development. For a more historical view, one of my favorite authors is William Ingdahl. He wrote a book called A Century of War. It's Anglo-American Oil Politics and the New World Order. It's the rise of global oil companies and the power that they have politically in setting, you know, where wars take place. It's not countries setting up where wars take place. It's these oil regimes themselves deciding, where do we need to invade? How are we going to justify this war? Because we need the flow of oil for our militaries and things like that. So really it's England as well as the United States that were converting their militaries from coal regime to an oil regime in the late 1800s. And that really is, that's all you need to know about the 20th century. If that never happened, the whole world would be different. There probably would still be an Ottoman Empire because Britain, totally destroy the Ottoman Empire in the Middle East to seize the oil during World War I. And that really was one of the major goals of England in World War I. It wasn't fighting Germans. It was really going into the Middle East and stealing oil and making sure their allies, the French, didn't have the oil. So this ontology view will give you a perspective very differently about the history of the politics of flows like that. But here's an example from USA of how oil can be a regime and not just a material. It's kind of this corruption intentionally hurts us because it builds a very uneconomical infrastructure existing by subsidies, not markets. So, you know, a lot of people say, well, oil's in the market, so the people have spoken. But sometimes things are in the market not because of their own profits, not because of capitalism, but they're in the market because they have a political deal that gives them no taxes and all their competitors have to pay the tax. Maybe they have special rules where they don't have to do any bureaucratic paperwork about that. And the oil is like that in the United States. Oil is very much like the way I describe the military. Remember I said, you know, militaries typically are above the law or beyond the law. Above the law means in legal text, it says you have no right to bother the military about environmental issues on their bases. And so there's no way the state can really improve that. Also, I said above the law and beyond the law is secrecy. There's a lot of secrecy involved. And the same thing is with oil. You can definitely see bribery and a lot of things happening to get their way in policies like that. But here's a very shocking thing you may not know about the United States. You may think the federal government's very powerful, and it is. But what I'm saying is what's really powerful are these political regimes of materials that are very, that have a huge flow and a huge strategic importance. You may not know that oil, gas, and fracking regime, fracking is hydraulic fracturing. It means pumping liquids into the ground, breaking the rocks, and trying to extract natural gas or oil from oil shale. Oil shale is a kind of rock that has kind of an oily, it's an oily sand, but it's very hard. But there's oil in that. But when you do that, you destroy the environment. But it's no joke, but the oil regime in the United States does not have to listen to the federal government about the Safe Drinking Water Act, the Clean Air Act, about hazardous waste recovery. They're, as I said, just like the military, they're above the law. It's written into law that they don't have to do this. These are pollution exemptions for oil and gas. The US Congress and many administrations, left and right, have given energy companies many exemptions to federal pollution rules over the last 40 years. Here are three major environmental statutes. These are rules. These are, you know, rules with loopholes. A Clean Air Act, the statute is designed to protect the public from hazardous air pollutants like benzene and lead compounds, establishing limits on each pollutant. However, oil and gas wells all over the United States are connected by roads and pipelines, but are exempt from submitting totals for each pollutant. So everybody else with a business in the United States has to follow the Clean Air Act, except the oil companies, period. That's a powerful regime. That's nothing to do with the market. That's like, here, we'll let you pollute. Go right ahead. That's awful. Other things going down here, this is another section of the Clean Water Act. The provision requires companies engaging in construction or large earth-moving activities to get a permit. You know, you have to get authorization for stormwater runoff, submitting plans, But oil and gas production sites, you know, all the oil rigs, they don't have to ever submit any reports. They can just put an oil rig wherever they want. Whatever things happen, doesn't really matter. The state is not allowed to touch them. They don't even have to have a planning requirement. So anybody can put up an oil rig anywhere you want. And it's very hard to challenge that. Anyway, third point here, Resource Conservation and Recovery Act. Law mandates, you know, requires all other businesses to dispose of hazardous solid waste. 1987 Environmental Protection Agency report described numerous toxic and radioactive substances in the waste of the oil and gas production. However, the US Congress passed a law that says the EPA cannot go and think about oil-fueled waste. So it's just they legally think everything from the oil industry is going to be considered by definition non-hazardous, And so therefore it's not true, but it exempts the industry from these mandatory safeguards. This is exactly like the military, what we described earlier. This is a political regime above the law, beyond the law, that creates environmental problems. And it's, you know, it's not the military per se, but it's industry. Different industries have these military style rules of privilege. They have these privileged uses of materials and the environment. And that's a problem. So what's the solution? Removing the exemptions, right? Or changing materials themselves. This is a view of where basically random oil pipelines go all over the United States. The United States from the early 70s has environmental impact assessment, EIA. And EIA, United States was the first country in the world to have an environmental impact assessment. That means everything you build has to be planned out, has to justify it, has to minimize environmental impact. That's sort of the final goal of all that. But except for the oil companies. The oil companies do not have to submit EIAs for pipelines. So pipelines can run anywhere they want. They're challenged on other grounds. So there's not really environmental impact or any wider national energy policy. Oil companies dominate where pipelines go. The federal government has no way to really guide that. And you can see this is where a lot of oil comes in. And there's a lot of old pipelines. There's duplications. There's, you know, some go in very sensitive ecological areas across the Gulf of Mexico. I mean, you could have done this and probably be safer, but no, they decided to go directly across a very, very ecologically sensitive zone. This is basically where one third of all the fishing of the United States happens. And so if any of these, any of these things break up, like the Deepwater Horizon, there's a big oil terminal in 2010, broke up in the Gulf of Mexico. If anything like that happens, you know, they kind of get away with it. I mean, this is very random, very weird kind of system when you think about it. If you can read about this here, about FERC sidesteps broader issues and approval of pipelines. So they don't have to deal with it. They don't have to deal with anything to do with the environment in a pipeline. It's not part of the legal grounds for stopping a pipeline, basically. That's why there's so many protests about pipelines, because the law really doesn't allow the law to touch them. So back to the point, the third point, you know, if we have unrepresentative regimes, why do we have that? I think we have that because of a condition. It's a condition, not all the time, but conditions of supply versus demand. What does that mean? We probably heard from economics of supply equals demand. And that's a happy situation, and I support that. You know, that means suppliers do what consumers want. That means leaders do what followers want. But sometimes they don't see that way. Sometimes leaders want to do something that the followers don't want. Sometimes big companies want to do things that their consumers don't want. And, you know, it's very fair to say the best thing to do is leave that company, right? But if these companies are very powerful, sometimes it's hard to leave that infrastructure. Like if you say, you know, tomorrow, maybe Kakao Talk for your taxis. Maybe they have a new national policy and they say, well, we're going to require a blood sample. You have to give us a blood sample every time you get in a taxi. A lot of people have no, you don't, you know, that's what I mean. There may be a conflict between the suppliers of a service and the consumers over the conditions of that. Ideally, you should find another system, but, you know, sometimes building your own taxi network is very hard. So the bias gets built in that people accept suboptimal things. And so I say, you know, this idea of suppliers versus demand can occur sometimes. It creates the unrepresentative situation. And that's how regimes can develop, where there's an interest in suppliers and having things that are bigger and stronger and more powerful and more profitable. But sometimes those bigger, stronger, powerful things create environmental problems on people or don't think about regional ecologies. And those kind of things can encourage environmental problems. And there's kind of four areas. You can unrepresentative suppliers over consumers. I think of GMO crops, for instance. 97% of the United States wants GMO crops labeled. It doesn't happen. Why? Because there's a powerful regime that doesn't want consumers to know if they're eating genetically modified crops, or doesn't want a warning per se. Unrepresentative political leaderships, sometimes over citizens. You know, the next Korean election is happening. there is a one right-wing person who was pushed out of the right-wing party recently in Korea. Why? Because he was anti-lockdown. So they pushed him out. I mean, so that was widely supported, but you're not, and that's what I mean. Political leaderships have made a decision autonomously not to do that. Both left and right are supporting lockdown still. Even if lockdowns worked, then they would have worked last year. Why are we still doing them? If they didn't work last year, why are we still doing them? So the damage of lockdowns are far more extreme. I recently read a statistic about the United States. 25% of all youth, this is like teenagers, have thought about suicide in the last year. That's a tremendously large number, 25%. It's estimated that about 60% of restaurants may never open again in the United States. I mean, these are massive damages that lockdowns are occurring. But political leaderships still continue to do it. There's another good example of conflict between leaders and followers here. Teachers and scientists, you know, curricula, I'm kind of going against the trend. I'm trying to teach you multiple things, but maybe some teachers just want to brainwash you and only tell you one thing, right? Tell you what's right, what's wrong. If you disagree, you fail the class. You know, I'm not like that. So, you know, but there are teachers like that, that will only like students that echo what they think. And that's sort of an unequal relationship. Unrepresentative financial relationships. There are bankers, you know, bankers that change the terms of your loan. You know, you don't like that, but that's how, you know, the banks have control over the loan holders. Maybe tomorrow the Korean, you know, they change the rules around Korean currency, and that's leaders over you. You're holding the Korean currency, so you're really part of that situation. And so those are examples of how supply or managerial structures can be different than the people who are using them. But anyway, that's my point. So what does this lead to? It leads to, well, there's two examples, the literature of where I get some of these ideas. These are close, but they're not really what I'm talking about, but all these are echoing what I'm talking about. I would say the closest may be these first two readings by Albert Hirschman or Joel Waldfogel, but it's the way he interprets this, I think, is slightly different than me. But moving on, moving down, the last point, ecological tyranny. What does that mean? I said that it's not just choices that cause bad problems. It's not just an unrepresentative regime that causes environmental problems. It's not just unrepresentative suppliers that cause people to suffer environmental problems, but it's sheer violence. There's a lot of history of technological repression, murder of inventors, people who were terrified that they don't, I mean, they have, you know, dead cats left on their doorstep if they, you know, open, you know, a green energy company. There's a lot of intimidation and violence. And I think all the big six that we talked about earlier really are very weak on thinking about how violence is used, not just by states, but how violence can be used by, you know, political regimes of materials that they don't want people to change. The previous book called Internal Combustion is really good on the violence of oil. You may not know this, but in 1914, Edison and Henry Ford, Edison is known for electrical innovations. Henry Ford invented the assembly line and cheap cars for everybody. And they teamed up in 1914. They had full page advertisements and they said, for the first time, Henry Ford, you know, mass producer of cars for the world, Edison bringing electricity cheaply to people in batteries. They're teaming up, and Ford was going to build a battery operated car. So Ford was trying to separate from the oil regime. And, you know, Ford was making most of the cars in the entire world at that point, because he's the first mass manufacturer of cars. So the issue is, the oil regime was about to be pushed out of all transportation, and it would have been a battery-based 20th century. But what happened? I mean, we don't know about this, but if you don't believe me, read this, the first chapter of that book by Edwin Black, Internal Combustion. A lot of violence happened. What happened? That factory was burned down within 3 months, and it was burned down intentionally. Somebody put gasoline canisters all through the factory and set it on fire. They not only set the factory on fire and destroyed it, they burned all the batteries, they burned all the documents. Edison had built a concrete fireproof building to keep all of his archive about all of his patents. Somebody burned that down too. Somebody threw oil and you know, it's poetically, but it was a gasoline fire. Somebody intentionally burned down Edison's whole archive of data. But see, most people don't like to talk about violence in public. It's very, you know, scary. And that's why I think nobody, it's why it should be talked about, because we have to talk about, that's a very important point of why we have environmental problems. People get killed trying to defend the environment. If you, there's like 500 people defending the environment who are environmental activists who died just a few years ago in 1 year, all over the world. They get murdered by who knows who, mafias or companies. It's hard to know because there's a lot of secrecy involved with, when you murder somebody. So I think there's a lot of violence. That means, you know, ongoing violence keeps bad materials in place. They will hire somebody to intimidate. They will get the federal government to make your patent illegal, that you can't use it, or they will confiscate, you know, use the power of the law to confiscate your prototype. These things unfortunately happen. And so I think to really solve that, we have to solve this unequal violence in society, that where people need to defend themselves and defend, you know, environmental improvements. And you need to be aware that, you know, sometimes inventing things, people don't want inventions. People really want to stop change. And that's, on the one side, there's a history of innovations in our world, but that's just one side. It's really built together with the history of repression and selection. And that's an important step in trying to solve environmental problems. So that's my point. Choices, you remember, solve ecological tyranny. Those four things work together. They follow from each other. Bad choices are you know, unrepresentative regime. Why do we have those unrepresentative regimes? Because of unequal leaders and followers. Why do we have unequal leaders and followers? How does it stay that way? A lot of violence sometimes is used to keep that unequal situation in place. That's a currently an unsolved thing, but I think we need to solve those kind of things to work on that. And that's all I wanted to say. That's my 4 points there in red on one slide. That my fixes would be more representative material choices if we have unrepresented choices. If we have these unrepresentative regimes, then we need more representative regimes. But we have to politically defend better choices in the market as well. If there is sometimes an unequal supplier interest against consumers, we need more choices. If there's more choices in the market, it's easier for consumers to escape bad situations and suppliers will be forced to adapt to create more sustainable situations. So I think providing more options allows consumers to leave bad, unrepresentative situations better. Also ecological tyranny, if violence causes that, I think we need to redesign the state to encourage more regional deliberation about material choices and not just leave it to federal politicians. Also, I believe we need a wider reformation in ways we think about way money and consumption works. But that's not what this class is about. But you know, see how you, when you start with a different ontology, and my ontology in one word is really flow, the flow of particular materials. When you think about that as the basis for your analysis, then you come to these different kind of fixes, very different than other people. And that's sort of me in a nutshell, so to speak.